Shannen,
the well-known pimp,
Edward,
narcotics king,
drama,
big-time racketeer,
LoveLine,
back in full force.
LoveLine is meant for an adult audience.
LoveLine may contain
action, intrigue,
exotica,
or even sexually oriented content.
Listener discretion advised.
Come on.
Now, here's LoveLine. In this corner, Adam Carolla. And in this corner, Dr. Drew.
Yes.
Sure.
You have?
Yeah.
From prostitute?
No.
No. Okay. Because sometimes the prostitutes will use one. I myself have never had oral pleasure with a condom.
There's a very strange thing sort of happening right now where people carry your age are sort of perceiving oral contact like that is sort of a matter-of-fact part of petting, and it's a very strange thing. I don't understand where that trend came from. Is that still going on?
I don't know.
Where there's sort of an acknowledgement that intercourse is potentially...
sociologist or something?
I asked the question probably in an unfair way, but I mean, there's sort of acknowledgement that sexual intercourse carries risks of pregnancy and sexually transmitted disease, and a risk of us intimate contact that people may not be ready for. So somehow young people decided that, well, then therefore, this thing is okay.
Right. It's basically why that sort of just say no policy doesn't really work in our society, because with the advent of AIDS and many other sexually transmitted diseases, we started in going back to this sort of puritanical road, and we said, look, stop having sex. No more sex. Wait till you're married or wait till you're older to have sex. And they went, all right, blowjobs and butt love. That was the answer. That is the answer we're getting from a lot of teenagers now. And it's like, all right, we're not having sex.
Yeah. I think it's still better. It's still better than not having sex. I would say.
Oh yes.
What?
You don't know about the butt love?
What is butt love?
Jennifer, be careful.
We have.
Don't go there.
A decent, and I'm telling you, forget friends till the end. Blowjobs and butt love. That is the name of the title for this special. That's going to get viewership. We have a lot of people calling in saying, I want to remain a virgin, or I'm scared to get pregnant, or my religion prohibits me from premarital sex. So we're going in the back door.
That's safer.
Well,
it's not.
That's what happens.
Well, I think that's a common problem with people that are raised in certain, you know, if it's a religious sect or whatever, if they're raised being taught that not all sex is sex. You know, people need to realize that it's sex, if you're going to believe that it's wrong, is all wrong, whether it's oral sex, whether it's...
Well, that's what's strange. I mean, how do people even define sexuality? If you're going to have sex with someone.
Right. I mean, I think that it's probably definitely better if not so many teenage girls are getting pregnant if they're resorting to having oral sex.
But I assure you,
just being responsible to begin with, you know?
Right. Sexually transmitted diseases, those can still be
absolutely
propagated.
Yeah.
All right, and we have to go to break.
Make them a little more promiscuous that way, too. I mean, thinking that they're probably safe and probably being a little...
No, it tends not to. They sort of are doing it as a way...
Listen, if you're given blowjobs, then you're being promiscuous. Are you not?
And then they're thinking,
I'm not getting pregnant. This is probably safe, so I can give more blowjobs.
But women don't.
Is that you talking now, Jason?
Yes, that is me. Actually, okay. I went through that whole thing a long time.
True. We're 5 minutes late for a commercial. Please stop the open forum on blowjobs for just a second. Sell the hell out of the next call. Right,
whenever a guy likes her, she loses interest.
Okay.
Now the LoveLine weather report for the nation. Mostly neurotic throughout the southwest. There'll be some scattered indiscretions around the Great Salt Lake.
LoveLine's phone number, 1-800-LOVE-191.
LoveLine will be right back. So you've got a couple of minutes to go catch something.
Still a virgin. I've had anal sex, but I am still a virgin. I've not had sex yet.
All right. Well, Drew, hold on. The mic's on. We're starting. All right. John Livingston is now in here taking the place of Jason London, who is now turning the official cameraman of LoveLine. Also, Shannen Doherty and Jennifer Blanc from Friends Till the End. January 20th, 9 o'clock NBC. I guess that's a Monday.
Yes.
Monday night.
And it's a Monday night movie, and everyone's good looking, and they're in college, and they're in a band, and everything's going great. And then Jennifer comes in and starts basically trying to hone in on Shannen's territory, starts moving in on the guys, starts moving in on the band. Eventually, what gets you to, like, toss out of the sorority or something like that?
She, like, takes over my life. I mean, she succeeds in every way possible.
It's like single white female.
Yeah.
Right.
For TV.
And your thing is you're like, what's your background in this?
I'm just completely obsessed with winning talent competitions I'm obsessed with her.
Do they hint at what your background has been that led you to be
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is what?
How much can I say? Everything?
Well, yeah, like she
your
was in...
cult abuse or something when you were a child?
No, I come from basically like, you know, I'm like basically trailer park.
Her character.
My character.
Yeah, she has like a mother who pushes her as well.
So she's abused emotionally
psycho.
In some ways.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. And Jennifer, it is you who brought in the video camera?
Yes.
All right. And you just got it?
Yes.
All right. I would sell it to a pawn shop tomorrow. I'm.
Is my talkback light supposed to be on? Out of curiosity.
Yes.
No, it is? All right.
No,
all right.
No.
Please. All right.
I can't hear you.
Right.
I'm just going to keep on playing with this.
Settle down. Please, don't make me discipline you. Jennifer.
Yes.
Here's the problem with these video cameras. Mm-hmm. I think of a video... I don't have a video camera. Drew, do you have a video camera?
Yes, we have three kids.
You do?
It's a requisite for children.
See, I don't have a video camera for the same reason I don't have a gun. Because I'm
somebody
scared.
Might use it.
Yes, it will be used against me. Ah. Something will happen. You're going to videotape yourself having sex one of these nights, and then the guy who fixes the VCR is going to come by, and you're going to leave it in the thing, and it's going to circulate all over North America.
Adam, I don't think you have to worry about that.
No.
Well, what if I videotape myself masturbating one night? True? Wouldn't that be dangerous?
Yeah, I suppose that might be.
All right, please. Settle it. Caroline.
Yeah.
23, you're on LoveLine.
Hi.
Hey.
I create a situation for myself. I seem to form a habit of taking an interest in a guy, and when he finally returns the interest, for some reason, I kind of lose mine.
What do you guys think that is?
How old are you?
I'm 23.
Oh.
It's a little old to be doing that, isn't it?
Well, it can't be chalked up to just, like, you know, teenage...
You'll grow out of it.
Yeah.
You'll grow out of it when you hit menopause.
So what...
I'm not trying to play a game at all. I really, when this happens, I have a sincere interest in this.
Have you ever had a successful relationship?
No.
Never?
No.
Do you have any, like, childhood problems with intimacy?
No. I mean, I don't think so, no.
Drew, should we gamble on this call?
I don't know if we're going to get anywhere with it, though. I mean, it's just obvious. Isn't it sort of obvious what you're doing for yourself there, Caroline? That you really prevent taking risk. You prevent being open. You prevent being vulnerable. And thereby, you prevent loss, ultimately.
Yeah, I mean, it just seems odd that you're having this problem. You haven't been, like, badly hurt in the past by a guy or, you know, something
badly
where
hurt
you're,
something,
you're, like,
something.
Closed up and
right.
defended.
Right, that can do it.
And,
Loss of a loved one when you were young, parent, mm-hmm. or something like
so
that?
So, to me, it's either low self-esteem or...
loss.
Or loss and fear of intimacy.
Right, because she doesn't want to get hurt. So she's
right.
interested. Then once they show interest, she sort of, like, backs off and says, no, I'm not interested
Well, it's
anymore.
A defense. I mean,
right.
feelings yeah. actually turn off.
But what happens, like, you start going out with a guy and then you just find things wrong with him?
It's kind of the same thing every time where I really, as soon as they start showing interest, like the longest that I've really been able to date someone is maybe a little over a month, and then I act like an idiot and try and do things.
Well, do you see them, I mean, when you first start going out with the guy, are you like seeing him every minute of the day or every single day or something?
Nope, not really. It's pretty normal, you know, like a beginning... developing relationships.
And then what do you experience? What's the feeling you get when you so-called act like an idiot?
Well,
what's the feeling you get that causes you to behave that way? Fear?
It kind of, like, panicky almost.
Fear.
All right, so you push them away through your actions?
Yeah, I suppose I do.
Okay. All right, so what do you want us to do?
The only thing that you can really do is, like, you know, I mean, if you're worried about being 23 and not being able to handle a relationship and you get, you know, all this fear inside of you and you panic and you push the guy away, after a month of going out with him, the only thing that I can really recommend, although I'm not a doctor, is going to therapy and trying to figure out why you have this problem.
Or leading yourself into a relationship, try to find one that is reasonably safe, and just hanging with it no matter how frightened you feel.
Never going to work.
You know, sometimes it can work.
No, she'll go on autopilot, and the urges will become too strong, and she'll act out.
You can't do that unless you figure out why you're doing it.
But you're right. If she is truly unable to take herself by the hand and just stay in that relationship and then observe herself and her feelings, then, yeah, there's no other way out.
Self-analyzation is close to impossible at this point.
I don't think she needs to find out why. I mean, right now, her excuse for not having a relationship is that she's spending all of her time trying to, you know, get intellectual about it and well, why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? Stop thinking about why and just go out and try. You know, if you want a relationship, try.
How many times have you tried?
It's probably been, over the past maybe 5 years, it's probably been about six guys. I mean,
did you feel special about any of those guys?
I really want something to develop.
We got that. We hear you.
Maybe you just haven't found the right guy. Maybe you're just an...
Doubt it.
I think she could do both. I think she could get into a relationship and hang with it and go to therapy.
Okay. Why don't you do that? There, I have an idea. Date the therapist. There you go. That's healthy. No, she's 23, and a lot of people don't come on to this stuff and get a handle on it and worry about work through it until their late 20s, early 30s sometimes. That's why I don't recommend marriage at an early age.
Oh, no.
Right, Shannen?
Well, what's an early age?
All right. I knew you'd be a strong supporter of that.
That's, you know, up to the individual, though. Early ages are, you know... Age means nothing. Right, it's maturity that means everything, my man.
All right, but think how immature it is to get married at 18.
I think it's incredibly immature to get married at 18, and most of the time they don't work out.
Think where your head was at 18 or 19. I don't know how old you are now.
I think that I was, I'm 25, but I think that there are, you know, everybody's different.
Right.
You know, 18, if you've been working since you were 10 years old, you're a much different 18-year-old.
Right.
Than the average 18-year-old.
I don't even know if in this day and age...
You don't want to get into this.
You can do this anymore. I mean, I think...
It's not something that I recommend. Look, at 18, you're still growing. You're still learning about yourself. You haven't discovered yourself yet. You know, definitely, I think most 18-year-olds, it's going to end. You know, I got married a bit too early, and it was a huge mistake.
What were you, like 21?
22, I think.
Right. And you were...
22 is not 18.
That's not necessarily too early for some
people. I'm not saying that that's too early either. I'm just saying that, you know, I was... basically, I was with the wrong person. You know, I mean, I would marry my boyfriend at any point in time now because he's the right person. I don't think has anything to do with it.
The reason you allow yourself to get into those kinds of relationships and consummate them is because you're young and you don't know any different and you don't have the judgment and the sense of self to be able to develop more appropriate relationships.
I think for normal 18-year-olds that you're talking to... Yes, you're correct.
I think
would I say for me? Absolutely not.
You have the capability of being responsible in a relationship. And my parents got married when they were 18. They're still together.
So did my
parents.
There
are people that are, you know, 30s and 40s, and they're irresponsible.
Do you understand how...
John, they hate each other, though.
Do you understand how unusual that is?
Just too lazy to get the
divorce. Not saying I have no problem with it. We have talked to people in the show,
too. I think that it's a different time. You know, I mean, my parents were the exact same as John's, and they've been married for, you know, 30 years now, and they're very, very happy and very much in love. And it's a different time, but I think it's also the way that you're raised. I mean, I really believe that. If you're raised a certain way, then I think that at 18 you can be mature and you can sort of have a sense of self and
make good judgment decisions. I'm really curious. What is the way you think people...
You know, I don't know. I mean, I was raised very family-oriented, and that family was the most important thing. I guess I was just raised to be a very, very mature person. You know, I mean, that's not to say that I didn't go through my own little bout, because I certainly did, which everybody goes through. But I don't know. It's different with every person.
It is different with every person. You and I have talked to 18-year-olds who had solid relationships. But it is statistically...
Right,
not
but,
good.
But yes, they want to get a threesome going this weekend. Those are the 18-year-olds we've spoken to. Yes, it's a different day in a different age. It is the age of MTV and the internet, and it's just a...
Yeah, but it seems like it should be going back to what it used to be, especially with everybody discovering... I mean, you know, this AIDS AIDS, every single different disease that you can get now, it seems like people should be going back to family. And
yes,
and
absolutely. I think there is a trend in that direction. A part of the population is moving that way. Another part of it's not.
I was raised by people that were very family-oriented as well, except for it wasn't our family. That was the only twist. We concentrate on the neighbors. All right. When we come back, we'll, are we going to have another guy come? Are we doing like some...
We're going to rotate.
No, you're getting screwed, though, John, because we only did...
I'll be back, I think.
You stay for another break.
Okay.
And then Cliff, is it?
Yeah,
we'll Cliff. Come through here. All right, we'll work it all out when we come back.
And a quick check of the out-of-town scoreboard. Wow, what the hell are they on about tonight, Pop? As usual, I have no idea what they're
doing. Call LoveLine, 1-800-LOVE-191. LoveLine, we'll be right back.
All right, phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number for LoveLine 310-854-4455. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Tomorrow night's guest, Ice-T. And tonight we have John Livingston as well as Jason London as well as, what's Cliff's last name?
Dorfman.
Oh, yes, that's right. Cliff Dorfman, who will be in here soon enough. Shannen Doherty and Jennifer Blanc, they are in a movie of the week on NBC, which airs January 20th, 9 o'clock. That is a Monday called Friends Till the End.
This coming Monday.
Already? Yeah, what day is it? Yes, that's true.
Make that clear.
All right. Drew, you love those movies of the week, don't you?
I can't get enough of them.
Okay. At least this one doesn't have two titles. That is my pet peeve for these things. Meaning, most of these things are called Friends to the End.
Colon, the evil ones or something.
The
days of...
I
did a movie a couple years ago called Betrayed, the story of three women.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's
perfect.
What we're talking about.
Perfect.
Right?
Yeah, or this one, the Kate Wickerman story, or whoever.
right.
But the point is they put the title of it, and then they tell us who the person you never heard of is
about.
It's based on. All right, thanks for the help. All right, we have the song, because you guys are in a band in this.
Oh, my God. What song do you
have? I don't know. Stop. We have a...
I heard you playing it.
What? Oh, stop? Andrew said in my ear. Andrew just went, stop. And I was like, okay. Stop's the name of the song?
Yeah.
All right. We'll take a call, and then maybe we'll hear a little of Stop. Is that all right?
That's fine. Cool.
All right. Knock it off, Drew. Dave, 20, you're on LoveLine.
Hi. Dr. Drew?
Yeah.
Hi. My girlfriend, after she orgasms, for a while after that, if she has to pee, she can't hold it in.
She's incontinent.
Incontinent, yeah.
Is she incontinent when she has the orgasm?
No. She says that if she doesn't have an orgasm for a long time or she doesn't do anything for a long time, then she regains more control. But if she does, then if she has to pee, she just can't hold it in at all.
Does it hurt? Is there pain with this?
No, she says it doesn't hurt. It just goes.
All right. Well, I mean...
But this is not female orgasmic incontinence.
No,
which
it's not.
Is a syndrome.
Right. It's not. This is just incontinence. And it happens after she's been sexually active. And, you know, there is spasm of the muscles around the bladder, basically the bladder neck, and the way the bladder empties can be impaired or can be affected by this sort of activity. So it's not necessarily the case that there's some kind of medical problem. Is she on any medications?
No, she isn't.
Does she do any drugs?
No.
Has she ever been pregnant?
No.
Okay. So she ought to be seen by the gynecologist and talk about this, but it's probably more about her evacuating her bladder beforehand, so she plans for this, and there are medications that can relax.
Well, all right, that means taking a leak.
And there are medications that can be provided to sort of relax the muscle tone down there. But by and large, I would just sort of, she needs to learn how to deal with it and make sure there isn't a medical problem, which there probably is not.
Okay, is there anything like vitamins or anything
No.
Dave.
Yeah.
You're out of harm's way by the time this goes down, right?
Yeah, but I hear about it, and now she doesn't like, she's scared to do anything because that's going to happen.
But it keeps happening afterward.
Afterwards, yeah.
How long has it been going on for?
It's been going on for like maybe 4 months or something. Yeah, and before that, she was okay.
If she's never been seen before, for goodness sakes, I mean, she could have an infection. She could, all kinds of things could be going on that could be reversed and treated. So she needs to get an evaluation, okay?
Yeah.
Please.
What is she, Amish or something? Send her to the gynecologist,
please.
She didn't
want to go to the gynecologist because maybe they would talk to her mom about her having sex.
How old is she, Dave? How old?
She's 17.
Dave, please.
How old are you?
I'm 18.
Please. Anything after 14 in most states is absolutely by law confidential between the patient and the doctor. Okay?
Okay.
Right. Kind of young, though, Dave, for a 20-year-old.
He's actually 18. It says 20 up here, but he said he's 18.
Oh, okay.
You're wrong.
I got to start paying attention to my show. Yeah. All right.
All right.
All right, Dave.
Okay, bye.
All right. Happy sailing. Jason.
Yes.
15.
I have a question for Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
I try to limit myself to smoking marijuana like 7 times a month, and I was wondering if this has any effects, like really bad. Like long term.
You're 15?
Yeah.
I'm of the opinion that any hallucinogen exposure, and people may disagree, but in fact, marijuana is a hallucinogenic.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Shannen gave the big wave off. Go.
Any hallucinogenic exposure before 15 or before tends to be associated with disruption of the normal brain development.
How old are you?
15. And here's a couple points. One is that chronic mood disturbances are sort of the hallmark characteristic that people get if they've used stronger hallucinogenics at 15 or before. I don't know that this necessarily is the case with pop, but I'm always concerned that it could be. I'm also concerned in your case, Jason, that you're so preoccupied with this drug that you have to hold it at 7 times a month or whatever it is.
No, I'm not really preoccupied with it. I mean, if I'm somewhere like at a party or something and they have it, then I'll smoke it, but I don't, like, spend any money on it.
You're not thinking about it?
No, not really.
Just if it happens to be there, that's it?
Yeah, I'll do it then.
All right, because marijuana addiction, people who become marijuana addicts preoccupy about it all the time, and it's very difficult not for them not to use it, and if they're not using it, they're thinking about using it.
So you smoke pot, like, twice a week?
Yeah.
Okay.
I would be very careful. I really would. I think you're in harm's way.
Okay. Really?
At 15? Yeah, not for a 20-year-old. You know, I know of no evidence that that level of marijuana exposure is going to hurt somebody, although it could over 20 years, I suppose. But for a 15-year-old, it concerns me.
Because your brain is that much different.
It's evolving. It's much more plastic. Yeah, absolutely.
So it's like at 15, it's a sponge, and at 20, it's like an anvil.
A brick, yeah.
All right. Yes.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks.
All right. Bye. What do you guys think about this whole medical use of marijuana and all that kind of stuff here in California and I guess in Arizona? Drew is against it. I am for it. And the argument is the following, and I've tried to explain this to Drew many times, but he has a very hard head when it comes to the hemp. The situation is this. His complaint is that this is a bogus bill. That it's only that this whole medical thing is just an excuse to legalize marijuana. Is that your position, Drew?
My position is if we're going to legalize it, let's legalize it. Let's have that discussion. Mm-hmm. But if we're going to pull a sham on the public in the name of helping people with chronic illness, that's not what this is about.
Okay, here's my rebuttal to that sham of an argument, Drew. They have been trying to get a dialogue going. Drew, Pollyanna Drew over here says, well, look, if they're going to legalize it, just open up a dialogue and legalize it, for Christ's sake, which sounds like a good idea, but people have been trying to open up a dialogue about this topic for 35 years. They will not talk to the politicians. The politicians will not talk back to them, and it does not happen. They will not listen. They'll never legalize it this way. So they did a little sham, and they went in the medical back door. That's what happened. You're exactly right. But you can't fault them because they wouldn't listen.
I have a question, something I don't understand. Now, isn't it true that cocaine is used for medical reasons and Valium? I mean, a lot of casual
addictive drugs.
Yeah. And marijuana isn't even physically addictive, is it?
Profoundly.
Yeah, it is.
Profoundly.
Not profoundly.
For some people, profoundly.
Okay. Not traditionally. I mean,
it is. I treat marijuana addiction frequently, and treating a marijuana addict is not a lot different than treating an opiate addict.
All right. What is more addicting, heroin or marijuana?
Heroin.
Okay. What is more dangerous? Cocaine?
Are we talking about a physical addiction or
profound? Addiction
really?
Is addiction. There's no addiction is the addiction or it isn't. You either can stop or you can't. And if you can't, there's a biological problem.
Yeah, but the physical addiction oftentimes comes with a physical reaction when one comes off of the substance.
No, that's dependency. That's totally different.
True.
You can be dependent and not even be an addict.
Who is the addiction medicine specialist in this room?
Right here.
Oh, okay. All right, the point is this. Marijuana is not as physically addicting as many, many drugs.
It is much more physically addictive than alcohol for some people. Much more.
For some people.
It is much more physically addictive.
A handful of people in Kentucky.
It's much more physically addictive than speed.
Did you have withdrawal symptoms if you stopped smoking?
There's not a lot of dependency in the state that there's tolerance
and
withdrawal.
Oh, I see. So you're talking about...
But there is like, people that are addicted get profound euphoria from the drug, and they think about it from every day from the day they get high the first time. And they use it every day, and they use it for an average of about 10 to 15
years. So you say marijuana is more addicting than alcohol?
Profoundly, for some people.
For some people.
For those people who
smoke of
marijuana and don't drink.
For a subset of alcoholics.
It's very much more.
It's always almost always in the setting of alcoholism, and it's a subset of alcoholics.
Right, Drew, you know you're taking the wuss road on this one. You know what I'm asking you.
No, what are you asking me?
What is more addicting, alcohol or marijuana?
Marijuana.
Okay, so there are more people that are addicted to marijuana and would have a more difficult time getting off of marijuana than there are alcoholics and people trying to get off alcohol.
No. But the marijuana addicts are having a more difficult time than the alcoholics.
All right. And how come there's
there are not more people.
The
you said there are
Ford
more.
Center. How come right. there's not the Bob Marley Center somewhere, huh?
Because
yes.
Betty, go
Thank
to Betty
you.
Ford and see how many marijuana addicts are treating these days. A lot.
All right.
A lot.
All right.
What are those bubbles?
That is Drew on the bong. Jay. 18.
Hello?
Yes, we what we did is we slid a mic under the bathroom door before one of the shows and caught him in there. There it is. Jay?
Yeah, I have a problem. I'm like a jealous boyfriend.
Oh, yeah, I know it. I can hear it in the voice. Yeah?
And my girlfriend gave me her virginity. And I'm supposed to, like, trust her more? Is that what she's thinking? Or, like, I'm not sure. I'm not sure what to do.
What are you jealous of?
Just of... her cheating or whatever. I mean, this is the first girl that I love and everything. I just don't want to get hurt.
Has she showed any signs of being untrustworthy?
No.
Then all you can do is trust her.
Jay?
You know, I mean, I'm sorry, but it's that simple. You have to trust until she gives you reason not to trust. And really, I mean, hard evidence that she's doing something wrong. Otherwise, you're just going to, like, close yourself off and lose her anyway.
Yeah, but I understand, like, having fears, you know, and sort of projecting them onto her and just, you know,
right. But that
creating
is the,
drama for yourself.
That is
in
the
your
fastest
head.
Way to get her to cheat, by the way. People do this all the time. It becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. They become so obsessed and so worried about people screwing them over that eventually the person screws them over because they've been worrying about it, because they've been treating them that way. You understand?
As though they already had.
Right.
Or they themselves are the ones that do the cheating.
Right.
So
yes.
You're saying if I just keep on acting like this, it's just going to push her away?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes. You'll drive her insane and she will fall right into the arms or possibly even lap of a friend of yours.
I mean, you love her, right?
Yeah.
So just, you know, give her, I know it sounds really difficult, but give her your love and trust her and, you know, see what happens. You can't, you know, look into the future. All that you can do is live day by day anyway.
All right. Drew, you good
Very
with that?
True.
Yeah.
All right. And we'll hear something from friends till the end when we return.
Love Live. 1-800-LOVE-191. On.
Love Line. We'll be right back. So leave a message at the beep.
Burn going here.
What'd you spill? Is that coffee or water?
I think it's water. It's
okay.
I'm fine.
Okay.
Thank you, Jennifer.
Well, this is life imitating art, isn't it?
Yeah, Jennifer's trying to wreck my life. She just spilled water all over me.
trying to.
She's like, those jeans look too good.
Trying to destroy Shannen Doherty's genitalia with a lukewarm tap water.
Thank you.
All right. All right. We'll be back. Hold on. It's a drill. Drew, relax. All right. Everyone settle.
I dropped my camera when I first came in here.
The name of the show is Love Line, and we'll be back in 10 seconds.
This is Love Line on Radio Station.
All right. Back with Shannen Doherty, Jennifer Blanc, and now Cliff Dorfman.
Yes.
Who is the third man who is...
The bass player.
Yes.
Oh, Cliff is the bass player.
Yes.
I am the bass player.
I'm sorry. And,
it's okay.
And you play Shannon's boyfriend?
No, that would be Jason.
Jason.
The guitarist.
Okay. I swore the bass player was the
but
one
you know,
getting there.
Can we do something
there was
real
an article
quick?
Written where they
one of my
that.
Best friends is Shannon's boyfriend.
We just want to take, like, 2 seconds to say something, Cliff and I.
Yes.
First, I want to say, Rob, I love you very, very much, baby.
Yes, and Drew, I love you, honey, and I'll see you when I get home. And not you. my girlfriend, D-R-U.
So we just want to say, you know,
Our loved ones in the tradition of Love Line.
Drew, you want to shout out to any of your homies, or you want to move on with the show? All right, speaking of shouting out to homies, Ice-T will be in here tomorrow night. Ice-T, who last time was in here, was talking about the, what was it, the freak chamber?
Yeah, yeah.
The freaky zone. Say you got to find a woman's freak chamber. And I still haven't figured out where that is, but Ice will probably give me an atlas to it when he returns tomorrow night. All right, Friends Till the End is the name of the movie of the week. It's January 20th. That is this coming Monday. NBC. And that's a Monday night, and it's a band, and they play, and there's some stalking going on, possibly
it's cool.
A cat
it's a
fight,
bit of everything.
And little country and a little rock and roll all together.
No so
country.
You have to watch.
Yes. All right, Drew. We're taking line 3. Sorry, Eddie, 23. You're on Love Line.
Going on.
Hey.
Hey, I got a question for you, and Adam, you're the only one who can answer it.
Okay.
All right, I have faith that you'll be able to do it. I'm from Minnesota. And as you know, it's half cold in Minnesota. In fact, tonight it's 25 degrees below zero, 60 below wind chill.
Really? Do you do any ice fishing, Eddie?
Well, actually, that's part of what I'm going to talk to you about.
Right. Because this ice fishing is an excuse for people to get loaded. Speaking about alcoholics, you sit on a block of ice and drink. That's it. Drill a hole in the ice, drop a fishing line in there, and get loaded. I don't think you even know it when you catch anything.
So, well, sometimes. It depends on the fisherman.
All right.
All right.
Do a lot of ice fishing.
You ready?
Yes.
Okay. The deal is this. I was wondering. Actually, several of my friends and I were wondering. The deal is when you stand outside in weather like this and you breathe,
right.
You can see your breath.
Right.
But why is it when you fart, you can't see it? Pants or no pants? We've tried it all. Want to know why you can't see it?
Got a little too much time on your hands, Ed.
Hey, I'm in Minnesota. If you're not at First Ave, you're on a block of ice.
Okay. All right, this is very fascinating. And, you know, scientists.
I like how I said you're the only one who can answer.
Well, I imagine, Drew, you probably sit around with your friends and talk about farts.
Yeah, absolutely.
Drew,
spend all
yeah.
my time with that.
Seriously, have you ever lit a fart?
No.
Okay. Me neither.
Adam, you have. I'll bet you $1 million you have. Come on.
Listen, I got to tell you about lighting farts for a second here. I've lit many a fart in my day. I really have. And I don't think it's anything to be ashamed of.
No, not at all.
And it completely kills the smell, and secondly, provides entertainment for now and me into the hundreds. People love it. I mean, and let me tell you something about lighting the farts, and then I'll talk about the steam coming.
Presses the ladies out of it, really does.
The chicks dig the blue flame. No, seriously, I'll tell you something about lighting farts, and don't all you guys take the high ground on this one. I've said in you know situations, look, I'm gonna light a fart, and I've had people just how immature, I can't believe it, a man of your age lighting his own gas, this is disgusting, and they're all full of themselves. But when I make the when I grab the Bic and I yell, get the light, because you got to flick the light off, otherwise it doesn't, you know, it's like watching the 4th of July at noon, right? Who
Been
cares?
There.
It's got to be dark, right?
Been there. Yep.
Right, that's when it really shows. The point is this: after lighting a fart or two. When I give the get the light yell, people are like a Who concert. They're going for that light, trying to knock that thing off. all claiming to be holier than thou, but when the bick hits the sphincter, they're all watching.
Exactly.
Believe me, they're all watching.
Exactly.
We do a lot of generalization on this show. When people are abused when they're younger, it sometimes will come out in this kind of, it gets eroticized in this way later on in life.
Right.
Yeah, but I wouldn't necessarily participate in it.
No, that's what I'm saying. No.
Yeah, I don't think that's a good idea.
No.
Corey got spooked is what happened.
Yeah.
And
rightfully so.
Yeah, and your instincts are probably right. She sounds, and listen, nothing wrong with a little rough trade. If that's what people are into, they're into. But well, she may have crossed the line, and it spooked you, and your instincts are probably right.
Yes.
This person probably has some issues.
Really?
And it may not be the best person to establish a relationship with. And once you consummate relationships like this, this is then where the stalking comes
right.
in and
that's
the
right.
obsession
that's right.
comes in.
That's right.
So
start there. Where are you going to go anyway? You know, you start right, off like, choking her. Where are you going to go? Try beating her with a stick first.
Break like a pool cue overhead or something on your second date.
You might want to rethink that.
No, I mean like lightly. I don't mean like in a violent way. I mean, you know, there's S&M and then there's, you know, crossing the line of death and you don't want to get involved in that.
Cliff, you like a little, you like the put your hand mark on a fanny once in a while sexually?
Well, you know. Just to my girlfriend.
Right.
Yeah, but yeah.
She's listening to that?
I'm sure, yeah,
okay.
Absolutely.
Right. I always can tell that mode.
No, it's no mode.
I always know when they're talking with the girlfriends.
But you guys have never discussed anything sexually?
No, we got rid of him.
Oh.
I'll answer
listening at home, contemplate that Jen. In your mind while you're listening.
I like this answer, though. It's like, how well do you guys know each other? Well, she is my cousin's girlfriend.
Yeah, I didn't get that. Like, so
cousin's
how well
friend.
Do you know each other?
Well, it's obvious. It's her cousin's girlfriend's friend. I mean, come on.
No, it's her cousin. It's her cousin's girlfriend's cousin.
No, it was?
Yes,
right.
No, it was her cousin's girlfriend's cousin.
Oh, okay.
That's right.
Does anyone know their cousin's girlfriend's cousin, by the way?
No.
I barely know my cousin.
Yeah.
Danny, 24.
Yes, hello.
Hey.
Enjoy your show very much, Dr. Drew, and don't particularly care to talk about lighting farts or
something. All right, well, that's enough from you. All right. Listen, I don't need any guy. Your show, Dr. Drew. Who is this, one of your flunkies you've paid to call?
No.
All right. I will not be dissed on the air. I take enough abuse in life. Sarah.
Hi.
18.
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, Sarah.
Well, about a month and a half ago, me and my friends were starting to get really heavy into crystal meth and speed.
Mm-hmm.
And I OD'd on it and had to go to the emergency room and everything. And ever since then, I've been having really bad mood swings and been really irritable and just not felt normal.
Since your overdose?
It is.
No, since the overdose you felt this way?
Yes, since the overdose.
And you've been off speed since the overdose?
Yes.
How long ago was the overdose?
About a month and a half ago.
Probably just the fact you came off speed. Very little to do with the overdose.
It is?
Oh, yeah. But people come off speed, they're very irritable, very uncomfortable. And if you don't do something, if you get involved in some kind of recovery program and replace that addiction with some sort of process, you're going to sort of get back into something eventually.
Okay.
Jennifer, you have anything to say to her?
How often were you doing speed?
Well, it started out where it would be just about once a week, and then I got...
What the hell's that?
And by the way, that's a more typical speed. So unlike marijuana, where it becomes a daily thing for the moment somebody first gets high on it, if they're going to be an addict, speed sort of slowly gets going.
Right.
And eventually it's a daily thing. And it's not even necessarily daily. It's a lot of speed addicts only use speed 3 or 4 times a week.
So how much did you end up with daily?
I didn't hear. Well, it started off once a week, and then it started increasing. And then the day I OD'd, I did about 4 quads.
All right, hold on a second. I'm not thoroughly distracted. All right, is Sarah's problems with boyfriend's cheating
on her? Not laughing at you.
What?
I'm not you, Sarah.
Sarah, you okay? Shannen just got a call on the Shannen line.
No, somebody wants...
Well, there, let me talk to him.
No, somebody wants to call in and ask a question. They're a friend of mine. So how do
oh,
I...
Oh, they want, like, the hotline number.
Yeah, but they want to be... It's you... Yeah.
Right. Okay, because if they just call the regular phone number, it's going to be busy.
Right. So, what's the other number?
Here they come. They come with it.
All right. We'll work that out off the air. All right. Are we done with Sarah?
Jennifer's talking to Sarah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You want to talk to her after the break?
Okay.
Some more, Adam?
Yes. All right.
Sarah,
hang
Sarah,
on.
Hold on, all right?
Okay.
All right. Don't do any drugs while you're on hold. Just hang on, all right? All right. Why don't we hear, Engineer Mike, do we have the full song from Friends Till the End? Is that like a 3 or 4 minute song? Okay. So we don't have time for that right now then. All right. I thought we just had a snippet. All right. We will hear the song. I promise you that. We will finish up with Sarah. Shannen.
Yes, sir.
Shannen will have a lengthy conversation with a friend on radio etiquette, and then I will talk to Shannen about radio etiquette.
That's, I'm so sorry.
That's
guys.
Absolutely fine, and we'll do all that after this.
Right back. Wash your hands.
Here we go. We started the show. 1-800-LOVE-191 is the phone number. 310-854-4455 is the fax number. We now have John, Cliff, and Jason.
And
the
Jennifer.
Hi.
And Jen.
Well, Jennifer, Jennifer and Shannen have been a constant here, a staple of Loveline. But now we have all three gents in the room because, and why, you ask? Why are all these three clamoring voices in the background?
Because we're going to do a number. Acapella.
Oh yeah, you guys. Well, you guys didn't do any singing, right? Just the ladies.
Yeah.
And what'd you do? Did you like do air guitar?
Well, we all play.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, we all play. So
we do play, but yes, we did.
We did air guitar with playback.
We did air guitar with actual guitars. Yeah, it wasn't in our hands.
Yeah, thank you, John.
They all could have played it.
No, I know you guys weren't up there with tennis rackets.
We could have been contenders.
Right. All right. You could have played. But you didn't.
That makes us sound like such losers.
It wasn't their choice.
Just you, John.
Jason. It wasn't their choice.
I wanted to play.
Not to play. They didn't know how good they were going to be.
They hired real musicians to record the tracks first.
Right. Yeah.
And they then recorded Jennifer's and my voices. And so everything was pre-recorded, and then everybody just pantomimed the action.
Right. And did you have to listen to the song over and over again and get all the riffs down?
And the chords and everything, yes.
Okay. So it looks totally realistic.
Absolutely.
All right. The name of the special, or I should say the movie of the week, is Friends Till the End. It's January 20th. That's 9 o'clock on NBC. Now I'm ready to dust off the VCR and record this thing because I got to know. I got to see how this thing... I feel like I'm the executive producer on the thing by now. All right. I want to thank Diamond Limo, who hauled most all of you out here.
Not me.
Is that correct? No, I know.
That's nice, Shannen.
I know.
We'll thank them.
Diamond Limo.
Shannen took a Learjet here. She's way too big for the limo. But thank you.
I drove myself, sir.
Thank you, yes. Yes.
Shannen took a Learjet.
Oh, my God.
But everyone else was hauled by the limo.
Well,
yes, it was lovely.
And I heard it was great.
No problems?
Gorgeous.
Looks like a nice limo.
As long as a football field.
Yeah, it's huge.
A light one. Nice.
Lincoln. Okay, Drew?
Adam.
You ready to go forward?
Back to Sarah.
Oh, Sarah, that's right.
Oh, yeah, our listeners.
All right, Sarah's situation is she's 18. She was into crank pretty good for a while. Then she went to rehab,
did she? No, she tweaked, and she overdosed, and she stopped a few weeks ago, and now is having a lot of mood swings and irritability.
Okay.
Which would be typical of stopping speed.
All right. Sorry.
Sarah.
I don't know if you're into it or not. It was not a Freudian slip. Sarah.
Jennifer was just about to tell her something.
Oh, go ahead, Jennifer.
You said you were doing it 4 times a week?
No, I started out at once and then once a week, and then it just got more, and within like a 3-day period I did like 4 whole quads, and that day the 3-day period I OD'd.
When you're way into it, what was your thinking like?
What was my thinking?
Yeah, what kind of thoughts were you having? Remember?
I always just wanted to do things. I never wanted to sit down. I just...
You weren't worrying about what your friends or family...
Hold on. Here's the part of the show where Drew asks a question. They don't give the answer that he requires. And then he injects her own feelings and emotions.
Let me give the answer.
No. Sarah, what she was feeling.
What she's feeling. What the typical syndrome.
Will you not learn? Every time you try this, it never works.
The typical syndrome is that people on strung on speed start preoccupying, getting paranoid about their family, friends, people close to them, co-workers. People who are high on cocaine or really into cocaine get worried about uniformed officers. They'd be completely paranoid that somebody with a uniform is right outside the door. Speed addicts run to people in uniforms to protect them from their grandmother.
Right.
It's a very different
I think everybody reacts differently.
No, it's a characteristic syndrome of
uniformed officers.
That cocaine addicts, almost without exception, become preoccupied. If they smoke enough on a big, big binge, will actually see policemen outside their door. They'll have visual hallucination that is always about army and police. And the cocaine addicts are ones that will dive under the table when the police helicopter comes by.
Maybe if we just gave all these people actual uniforms of their own.
Speed addicts, the paranoia that develops with speed is very slow to come on. It's very insidious. And first, it's just that you kind of saw your mother and your grandmother talking, and you became convinced they were talking about you. And this very, very elaborate delusion will develop, and it's always about people close to you.
Sarah, for my own edification, can I just ask you, what exactly is a quad? Can you explain that? Like, how much is that?
You can usually get about 3 to 4 lines out of it. It weighs 0.025 of a gram.
Okay, what exactly was the question, though?
All right, so it's a quarter, I guess...
Quarter of a gram.
The point I'm hoping we'll make is that you've got to do something about this.
And what is your reason behind doing drugs? Is it just to fit in, or are you trying to escape certain feelings, or is it just, does it make you feel better than you feel normally? I mean, what's your reason?
Well, at first it was me and my boyfriend were having fights and everything, and that I just did it and I felt really good, and then I started noticing it make me lose weight, so I just kept doing it.
Wait,
Jennifer, have you done a bunch of speed?
Yes.
Oh, okay. And were you hooked on it?
Yes.
And did you go through rehab and everything?
Yes.
How long ago was that?
8 years ago.
And everything's been good?
I've been completely sober, actually, since.
Because it's...
But I understand that when I was doing cocaine, I did it... partially in my head. I mean, I did it for a lot of reasons, but part of the reason in my reasoning at the time in my head was I thought I was getting really skinny. I was throwing up a lot, and because I was doing large quantities, and I thought I was getting really skinny. It's usually in your head. You're usually not as skinny as you think you are.
Was it coke or speed or both that you're into?
It was meth and speed.
Meth and speed,
I was asking Jennifer, but was it
meth and speed are exactly the same thing? Methamphetamine is speed.
Right.
Yeah. Mine was cocaine.
Okay.
But it's pretty much, it's
got a lot of speed in it,
yeah.
Right. But I have tried crank before, and I've tried coke before, and crank really has a lot of speed. I mean, it's all speed. And coke, depending on how much speed whoever...
Cocaine is different.
They're both
stimulants, but cocaine is very different.
Right. All right, so Sarah... You have to then get yourself into some treatment, right? Because
Absolutely.
It's going to be tough to kick on your own.
It's not going to be something you're likely to stay off. You'll switch over to something else. Mm-hmm. These mood swings you're having could get a lot worse. You've got to do something to treat the entire spectrum of disorders you have here. So give your doctor a call. Give a resource a call.
How old are you, Ken?
She's 18.
18.
All right. Well, she can get into, CA maybe?
Call CA. Call NA, really, is what you'd want to do.
Oh, okay.
She can even go to AA.
AA, absolutely.
As long as it has an A at the end of it, you should show up. they'll help you. All right, Treva?
Hello?
18, you're on Loveline.
Yes, my question is for Dr. Drew.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to know, if you get your nipple pierced, will it affect yourself later on in life, like when you are pregnant and have to breastfeed?
I don't know for a fact. You should ask whoever does the piercing. These are the people that really know more about this than really anyone. But I would imagine it would make it more difficult. Breastfeeding is already remarkably difficult. Most people have a fantasy that it's something that just happens naturally. But it's something that mother and child have to kind of learn how to do and hopefully take to them. I mean, every hospital now has breast what do they call them? They're actually breastfeeding specialists.
Really?
That coach.
How does one get into this field, Drew?
I think
I have a certain amount of experience from watching a lot of movies. I don't have any, you know, formal schooling.
No, they're trying to pass a law right now that if anybody stares at any woman breastfeeding her child or makes any lewd remark or obscene gesture, that she can actually sue them and have them arrested. It's kind of like an anti-defamation thing.
Really, it's the ogling act. Listen, here's the sad part about the breastfeeding. Right when the mother and child finally start, you know, hitting their stride and getting it down, it gets weird, you know, because the kid's into his teens at this point. All right.
Why do you want to get your nipple pierced?
That's a good question.
Because I heard that it's very erotic.
What, like when they pull on it during sex?
Oh, yeah.
How old are you?
18?
Why do you want to start getting all crazy now? You got your whole life to do that. Why don't you start simple?
Well, why not?
You got something.
These days, that is simple.
I mean,
because you get too smart to do stupid stuff when you get older. That's why you do it now.
It's all about the nipple anyways, right?
I'm thinking you may be able to feed 3 or 4 kids on one breast if you do the piercing. From
go for some of
one of those rain birds you put on the lawn. Treva.
Yes.
All right, so we have this call a lot. Apparently, it's all right. It's workable. You can get the nipple piercing and then later on go on to breastfeed. But we're all sort of sitting here and saying it's probably the type of thing that you're going to do now, you'd be happy with for 6 months, and then you may regret it later on down the road.
Ask your gynecologist, though.
We can't make breastfeeding easier, and I'm saying it's already a difficult thing.
I've had a lot of friends that had so many problems with breastfeeding, as it were.
Imagine that. Absolutely.
I can imagine it only causing more problems.
That's right. That's the point.
Julie, 13, you're on LoveLine.
Oh, my God. Hi.
Hey,
Julie.
Hey.
Julie.
My child.
I have a question for Dr. Drew, and I also wanted to say to Shannen Doherty that 90210 sucked when you left, so.
Thank you.
It was pretty cool when you were there.
Thanks. I agree, too.
Yeah.
Me, too.
Thank you, Julie.
Yeah,
Drew stopped watching. He boycotted the show immediately after that.
Yeah, I did too.
So I just wanted to ask Dr. Drew, I have like jelly stuff coming like out of my vagina, like it kind of looks like mucus, and
just Smucker syndrome. I've heard of this.
What?
Hold on.
But what
13. Does this happen? Come on now, Adam.
All right.
Yeah.
Julie, does this happen just prior to your period? Maybe for a week or so prior?
I got it at 11, and I had my period.
No. Mm-hmm. Are you menstruating normally now, regularly?
Yeah.
Do you get this discharge mostly just before your period?
No, I get it pretty regularly.
All the time?
Yeah. Okay. And I don't know what it is. You know, I take showers every day.
Are you sexually active?
No. Yeah, okay. And I don't want to be until, I'm married.
Great.
Hey. Good girl.
Good attitude. Hey.
Really?
Julie.
And for anyone that wonders why someone should be that way, just listen to this show for an hour and you'll understand why Julie is correct. But right. Julie, some women just...
My prediction, she'll be pregnant at 15.
Julie,
God forbid.
Some women, the reason it's happening now is because you have gone through puberty and the hormonal changes does change the environment down there, and some women will just produce some of these things. It can be normal.
Like, it's not abnormal?
Not necessarily at all.
Okay, because I was scared, because I didn't know what the hell it was.
You can get vaginal infection, yeast, things like that. You might want to get some over-the-counter cream like gynelotrimin.
I've been checked by doctors and stuff. I haven't talked to them about it, but they checked down there when I had a physical, and they said that everything looks fine.
You might really just want to get some gynelotrimin over the counter and use it for a few days, see if that helps clear it up a little bit. But in all probability, it is something normal.
Can I ask another question?
Yeah.
Okay, my brother, he...
I was thinking, you know, if you had peanut butter coming out of your ass, you got a sandwich.
A lot.
Yeah, an interesting thought process, Adam.
Oh, she's fine.
Leave her alone.
No, she knows the spirit of what she was meant.
Go ahead, Joy.
See?
My brother, he used to be heavily into marijuana, and now he just does, cigarettes and stuff. And I've noticed that when he started doing this, he started acting really bad towards me and towards my mom, and he always beats me up and stuff. And I don't know what to say. I try to talk to him about it,
And how old is your brother?
He's 15.
Okay.
And he's just, one time he beat me up so bad that, my mom kicked him out of the house.
Good.
Huh?
That's good.
I know,
that's what your
but
mom should do.
He came back, and I think that he's like my dad because he smokes marijuana too.
Yeah.
And, you know, he got some from my dad that my dad didn't know.
By the way, parents, the greatest way to assure yourself that a child's going to use drugs is to do it yourself, no matter what you say.
But, like, I was, like, talking to my mom because me and my mom, we have, like, a really good relationship. We're, like, best friends. And I was talking to my mom about it and, like, about myself because, you know, I used to smoke cigarettes and stuff. But, I mean, I was talking to my mom about the way my brother acts towards men. You know, I don't see other brothers acting like that towards
Julie, it's men, you shouldn't.
Does like marijuana and cigarettes have an effect on like how you act?
Sure. It's in the marijuana camp. Not usually that way.
No, he should become docile.
I would suspect he either has something else going on psychiatrically or psychologically, or he's doing other drugs like speed, which makes people very violent.
Is your father abusive at all?
Is your dad abusive, Julie?
Huh?
Has your father ever been abusive?
No.
What about
way.
Like an uncle or one of his, you know?
No, I've never been like abused. My parents are like really cool.
We're wondering about your brother though.
Yeah,
whether somebody
brother,
got to him.
That's why he acts that
way. Doesn't really talk that much. You know, whatever happens, he just like keeps it to himself. You know, he doesn't talk about things.
All right, where is your brother? Is he home?
Yeah, he's asleep.
Oh.
You want me to wake him up?
Time to go.
Well, yeah, if you won't beat you.
I didn't want to talk about it because he was listening, like, on the radio, but do you guys want to talk to him or something?
Adam, no.
Is there any danger that he's going to abuse you if he wakes up?
No.
No? All right. We'll talk some sense into this lad.
But, like,
Julie.
Go wake him up.
We got to go to a commercial.
Okay.
We're going to put you on hold.
Okay.
Go wake him up.
Okay.
A good swift kick to the groin always wakes up.
Took the words right out of my brain.
All right, be careful.
Okay.
All right, go in there with like a trash can lid in front of you and make sure.
Tell him that Shannen Doherty wants to talk to him.
Doesn't get violent.
All right,
okay. And we'll talk to him. And Shannen will tell him about some people she knows in the underworld.
You're not kidding.
No, I'm totally serious. That's why I'm being very respectful tonight. All right, so when we come back, we'll talk to Julie's brother.
Now the LoveLine weather report for the nation. Mostly neurotic throughout the Southwest. There'll be some scattered indiscretions around the Great Salt Lake. Also overnight, partly chronic in parts of Virginia.
LoveLine will be right back. So you've got a couple of minutes to go catch something.
Back with friends till the end. The cast, which is Monday night. This coming Monday night, 9 o'clock NBC, movie of the week. When we left off, we were speaking to Julie.
Hi.
Did you arouse the sleeping giant or wake the sleeping giant?
I woke him up, but he doesn't want to talk. He got mad, so he doesn't want to talk.
Okay.
So.
Are you going to be okay?
Huh?
Are you going to be okay?
Yeah, I think he's going to be fine. It's just he's
not him. You
not him. You.
Oh yeah, I'll be fine. It's just you know, like every time he does it, like I get really like emotionally like messed up because you know he's my brother. He's supposed to be like sticking up for me. You know.
No, Julie, that's the fantasy. But stay away from him. He's got some problems
also,
right now.
Yeah,
he will realize he's going through adolescence or something.
But
he will come around, I suspect. But for now, you've got to ask your parent for some protection.
Yeah, I'm worried about yourself because you really sound like you have a great head on your shoulders, and you sound like a great girl.
You got to get your Hesher dad to intervene and right. You know have
get
a little
the bond,
break him away from the bond. Yeah. I was just gonna say.
But, tell him to go kick his butt.
You know, I want to like. You guys are going to laugh, but I want to be an actress, but, you know, like...
Why would we laugh?
I don't think that if, like, my brother is doing this to me, it's going to, like, mess me up, dude.
No, that'll make you a great actress, believe me.
It will. Yeah. It will. You gotta have some,
You gotta have some strife.
Something to go on, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
No, the only one that can mess you up is yourself.
Yeah.
You know, just remember that.
I'm trying to, like, keep away from, you know, bad stuff and everything.
All right,
stay
real focused. Do what you're doing. You've got it right now. Don't lose your perspective.
But get your parents involved if he's getting physically abusive, especially your mom, who you have a good relationship with.
Parents have to be the parents.
Thank you for that, Drew. Tony.
No, parents abdicate that responsibility off live. They've got to be the parents here and get control of the situation.
Right. I will be wearing the parental pants in my family one day, God willing, if I ever have
God forbid.
All right, please, with the Lord's name in vain. You know I am. Tony, 22, you're on Loveline.
Yeah.
Hey, how you guys doing?
Good.
My question is really for Shannen and Jason. I was wondering what it's like to, first of all, to do big screen movies compared to, like, TV movies of the week and stuff. And my second question is also, how's it working with Kevin Smith?
That's a Shannen question.
Well, okay, working with Kevin Smith, he's fine.
You know that was my brother, that wasn't me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was Jason's Jeremy twin, Jeremy, who did Mallrats.
Who we've had on the show a year ago.
Oh, yes, I believe so.
Yeah, real nice guy, by the way.
Good looking
fellow. Even nicer than you.
And you're unbiased.
As far as working, like, the difference between big screen and little screen, I think that there's a lot of snobs who say, like, film is so much better, and I'm sort of one of those actors that believes that as long as you're working, you're doing really good. You know?
Yes.
As long as you've got something to do.
Yeah, I mean, not that you have something to do. I mean, hopefully it's giving you a challenge, but working is sort of using, is making you a better actor to begin with. Especially if you don't take acting classes, then each acting job is your acting class, and more experience is better. Right. The only difference is movie of the weeks are 2 hours long, almost the same as a film, and they're shot in 4 weeks. A film is shot in like 3 or 4 months, so you have more time to focus on like one scene.
Right. I just did a feature in 2.5 weeks.
So. And the movies I watch are shot in a day and a half. And they're done in Van Nuys.
In a little sound studio. Warehouse.
They go 2 days. It's like the producer goes nuts.
There's
like also
a lot
the director
of
and the writer.
That,
but
shot in people's backyards and stuff.
Right.
But there's a lot of TV that's much, much, much better than film. You know,
absolutely.
I've done a lot of TV work that, in my personal opinion, blows Mallrats away.
Plus,
but almost everything blows Mallrats away.
I like Mallrats. Please.
I disagree.
Well, thank you.
I actually like Mallrats.
I think that just up until recently that there's been such a, like, this connotation that you know, there was something better and more respectable to do features. And I think with the crossover of so many talented people in television doing features now, that they're basically one and the same. And it's basically proved that if you have the talent, you're going to maintain a career regardless of what venue you do.
So you can do schlock, and it's not necessarily the medium.
Yeah.
I mean, you can do schlock on TV, you can do schlock on the big screen, or you can do it, or vice versa.
If you're something great on TV, you're getting film, it's great.
And you can do a really piece of crap movie, but you could be great in it, and you'll get another job. It's just a matter of how you do yourself.
Yeah, all right. Drew is dying to hear the song from Friends Till the End.
Stop.
He absolutely is. You saw the magic board there. It's a song. He pounces when he doesn't get his way. So
which song are you playing?
Stop.
Yes, we're going to play the song Stop. This is from Friends to the End, and this is, if you hate it, send that
don't
mail.
Yeah, way to put out that positive energy out there.
Please don't hate it. We worked really hard.
I'm sure you'll love it, but this is...
we really worked hard, so...
This is Shannen and Jennifer both doing the vocals on this one.
It is a cold. You and I both know I don't need control. Need to fill the holes. Just a little soul. Easy as we go. That's what I do know. If easy does. See the towers go right up on the stars. We are not so old. We have miles to go. We'll be right back.
Yeah.
Listen.
Wow.
That is good singing for people I haven't sung before.
You guys could have left it at that was good singing.
That was damn good singing. That was an excellent song, and I'm sure we'll make its way right into the K-Rock rotation. Just a matter of days. Is that did you say Susanna Hoffs?
Susanna Hoffs wrote that, yeah.
And Kevin Hunter.
Now, isn't that strange how even though she wasn't singing it, you could definitely...
Tell it was her stuff.
Was she was she coaching vocally or anything?
Because
it sounded like her her style.
No, Seth Briggs was our vocal coach. Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah.
All right, so Monday night, 9 o'clock...
NBC.
What's the name of it again? Okay. Friends, till the end. You can hear, and there's some upbeat stuff, too?
Yeah,
some
there's,
rockin'
I mean, there's,
stuff.
A, yeah, there's a lot. Yeah, there's five songs total.
Now...
And a video.
Are you guys...
Full shot video.
Are you guys trying to kill each other during this scene? Or you, is this like...
No, not during this one.
This is when you're friends at the beginning.
Well, yeah, but... Yeah.
Okay. All right. Now, producer Ann's trying to sue me because Jennifer's mom is on the phone. my mom ever called this show a killer. Hello? Jennifer's mom?
Hi.
Hi, what's your name?
Poupe.
Denise.
Denise, how are you?
Fine. Denise. How are you?
Good.
That was the greatest song ever.
Did you pay your mom to do this, Jen?
This Monday, January 20th, Prince.
Yeah, she didn't even get paid to say that.
Underline this.
Hey, Denise.
Yeah?
Janice.
Yeah.
Oh, boy, I'll never remember that. Janice.
Yeah.
Now, are you like a showbiz mom? Did you take Jennifer out to auditions when she was young and all that stuff?
Not a showbiz mom, but I did take her all over in New York.
Oh, you did, too?
Yeah. Well, all over.
For, like, auditions and things?
Yeah, auditions and, you know, like, all over.
All right. And you're not worried that warped her in any way?
No.
No. Okay. Because she's quite lovely.
Great.
And I'm guessing you're kind of a hottie, too, just based on the looks of your daughter.
She is.
Am I right?
Yeah.
Right. She's beautiful. She is. My mom's beautiful. Inside and out.
She's my biggest fan.
I am. I love you.
Really? What do you do?
I have a business.
Oh, okay. I thought she was in a band or something. I didn't know. I heard the fan part.
No, but her husband.
My husband's a musician.
Okay. This is not... Your dad, this is a husband.
Yeah.
Stepdad.
Right. All right. Everything good there? You like him?
I like him.
You don't resent him or anything because step-parent?
Yeah. We just got married.
Oh, really? Uh-huh. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
You live here in the L.A. area?
In Topanga Canyon.
Ah, very beautiful.
Yeah.
A lot of hippies up there making pottery and smoking hooch.
Oh, well, I don't know about that, but it's pretty.
Okay, Janice.
Yeah.
We got to go to a commercial. Say, okay. Say, I love you to your beautiful daughter, Jennifer.
I love you, Jen.
I love you too, Mom.
Yeah.
We love you too, Janice.
Thank you.
Bye, Janice.
All right, she's totally sober. You understand? She's doing fine. All right.
Oh my.
Well, I didn't want her to go. I didn't want her to think that there's some sort of relapse or something that went on the air. All right, Drew.
Yeah.
Thank you for operating the phone for me, and we'll be back.
Hi! LoveLine's gonna be right back.
All right, play the beat. Play the damn beat.
What's going on?
Where the hell's the beat?
Where the hell's the damn beat?
We're sorry. Listening to LoveLine.
The opinions expressed on LoveLine, especially by Adam Carolla,
are not necessarily those of the staff, management, or sponsors.
Or even the character voices.
LoveLine, produced by Ann Wilkins for Westwood One Entertainment. Copyright 1996. So don't even think it.